Okay, thank you, Simon. Good afternoon, everybody. Today I want to present my research at Eindhoven University of Technology, which is originally started about 10 years ago. And as you can see from the title, this is structured reactors under inductive heating. So I would like to introduce this first, what are structured reactors. I think most of you know this, and a little bit more about inductive heating. So first of all, is a big picture, which obviously reflects the directions of our research, is in fact electrifying of chemical industry. So in the future, natural gas will be replaced by sustainable electricity, and there are multiple ways of doing it. One is, of course, via electrocatalysis. One is via plasma catalysis, and it's also possible to do it via techniques like microwave and inductive heating in case when you replace just the heating part of the system. So that's what becomes interesting. And as I already mentioned, this research originates from the first findings that we done in this system when you can basically multiplicate either microwave or inductive heating reactors in order to scale up. Because what's the main problem with chemical industry, why the technology is still not implemented? That's the issue of scaling up. And today I also want to touch this very briefly, but just to introduce the concept, it's basically very simple. You have a waveguide in which this red color here on the left-hand side shows a standing wave, which is a microwave at a frequency in a gigahertz range, the same as in a kitchen microwave furnace. But here it's just caught between motorized short circuit and the auto tuner. So in a such a way that the maximum of electric field is always positioned on the load, which is in fact chemical reactor. The approach works, it can provide very high heating rates, and essentially it was also demonstrated why it has one essential problem. It cannot be scaled up beyond some diameter because the microwave have a limited penetration depth. So once you increase your diameter, attenuation of microwave field becomes so strong that the middle of a part of reactor is not get any energy at all. And then the problem becomes essentially the same as unconventional heating. So you really need to introduce some kind of stirrers or any other means to mix the flow, which does not help much if you want a compact design. However, separately from that inductive, or it's also called radio frequency heating, it operates at a considerably lower frequency, typically in kilohertz range. It can also go to megahertz if you need, but typically it's between 100 and 500 kilohertz where the most applications are working. Obviously, material itself would not absorb energy in such wavelengths, so you need to make another material which would. So this is typically called a susceptor of energy. And these are materials which can absorb either electrical or magnetic part of electromagnetic field. And it's quite often it's done on magnetic part. And the materials which are absorbing magnetic energy, they are called ferromagnetics. And nickel ferrites, for example, one of such materials which has also high Curie point and can be heated towards relatively high temperature, I would say 500 degree centigrade. And if you need above, then some other methods can be applied. So advantage of induction heating, it's high penetration depth, so it's convenient to apply for bigger scale reactors. It's also much safer operation in terms of safety aspects, but in case microwave leaks from the reactor, you have a major problem because in a worst case scenario, the whole process basically needs to be shut down and it requires a lengthy restart. Also, you can get a temperature gradient if needed. It can be good for equilibrium limited reactions and also high heating rates. So we demonstrated up to 100 K per second. It's quite possible, but in many cases, you don't need even that fast. And as I already mentioned, we need magnetic material, so the control, the upper limit of heating can be controlled by adjusting Curie temperature of this material. That means at which temperature material can lose its magnetic properties, and it becomes typically super paramagnetic, which provides much lower heating, if not at all. So this seems very simple concept, except of course that we need to master preparation of magnetic material and generally scale up. Because energy would be continuously added to the flow from inlet to outlet. If you not do structured design, you will get an increase in temperature profile from inlet to outlet, which is logical because if you have continuous source in your reactor, you will get axial temperature profile. And on top of it, you also have sometimes radial temperature profile, which in fact creates additional problem because if material has very low heat conductivity, you may also have a difference over radial direction. The problem has been solved by numbering up approach when you can interchange catalytic zones with the heating zones. You can also increase diameter to some extent. Typically 10 centimeter diameter is quite feasible in these applications. And this is also compatible to other technologies which have multi-tubular design. And of course, you can also position multiple reactors inside the inductive coil. The generators are available up to 500 kilowatt, which is typically enough for bench scale applications. And they also can go to megawatt range if you can extend it towards a pilot scale. So this is what was presented before, and this works quite nicely at steady state operation. You can get almost isothermal type of operation along the reactor, which we demonstrated was combined from 19 sections. So it means 19 catalytic zones interchange with 19 heating zones. So the total reactor length was above 1 meter. Yet there is still room for further improvement, and that's what also I want to discuss today. The topic of today's lecture is, in fact, could we also do more than just do this type of operation? So how we can do more? And the answer is we can do forced periodic operation. So instead of doing it at steady state, that's what we also we teach our students maybe for the last 60 years. So the process control is devoted to a system which should operate at this state and not go to run away, because any runaway is considered as an incident. So here we do it opposite. We intentionally create forced periodic modulation of one or multiple parameters, which could enhance either selectivity or reaction yield, or even both, beyond the steady state limit. So in order to do this, of course, it needs to be a special approach and the theory which comes from process control here. And I also want to do a short introduction about this, maybe 10 minutes. Otherwise, it would be relatively difficult to move forward. And after that short introduction, I want to go to some applications and also touch the preparation of magnetic materials, which I mentioned, because this is an integral part of the whole structure. So we need to master the periodic protocol. We need to master magnetic materials. We need to provide the tools how to measure temperature quickly, because periodic response usually needs to be done in order of kinetic constant of your reaction. And in many cases, these are seconds. Obviously, we cannot go beyond seconds because when the thermal inertia will play a role. But as I presented in a previous slide, if you get such modular concept with multiple tubes running in parallel with multiple heating zones, then the cooling becomes a problem. fact, not with heating as such, because periodic means that if you're talking about temperature, for example, and it's mainly about temperature today, then you also need to provide fast cooling, not only heating, in order to create some periodic process, which may, I guess, enhance. You can argue, of course, that this is also wasting of energy, but again, we are talking about such reactions where the costs of chemicals are much higher than energy costs. Obviously, it would not work for all, but I just want to focus on sectors which are related to pharma and to some extent fine chemicals, which are produced on 100 kilo a day scales and sometimes beyond, but quite typically on that scale. And one particular example I want to talk about: glucose hydrogenation isomerization. It's not mentioned here, but you will see it later, which is one of dream reactions in this type of sugar transformations. Because to isomerize glucose to fructose going further to 5-HMF, it's one of important processes in biorefinery industry. And then I also want to conclude with some future views. So as I already mentioned, the future chemistry will be electrified and focused on renewable sources. So that's the two initial points in order to justify the choice of a system. And then again, as I promised, let me just start with a brief introduction of the method. So how to do periodic operation and how to do it correctly, because if you do it incorrectly, you can make the situation even worse when a steady state type of situation. So it's not a new method, what I need to say, but first investigations and publications were updated to late 60s and beginning of 70s. And different groups was working on this in, at that time in the US and in Russia. And later the method was adopted also by some other groups in Europe. So since then, of course, was some progress, but not many. And the main reason for that, it's difficult to arrange a very fast modulation inside a reactor just technically. Mathematics was there, but it still remains the technical part. So how to do heating quickly, how to do cooling, and how to do it also periodically, because the second cycle should be equal to the first. Otherwise, there will be no periodicity and in fact will be canceled out. So first of all, I need to go through the details of chemical reactor. And chemical reactor is in fact the system which you feed reactant in and get reactant out. And which, if you just consider a simple example, which A goes to P, where A is reactant and P is product, that's one of the simplest cases which possible to think of. And we have parameters, input parameters, which is concentration, and output parameters, which is concentration of product. And they have subscript S here, means that they are at steady state, and that's what typically industry does. So we try to keep it at steady state. But if you do modulation, and it could be done by multiple cases, so you can do it either via concentration, you can do it via flow rate, or you can do it via temperature and combination thereof. So today I want to limit the case to a single input. We also demonstrate that we can do multiple input, and there is also a new methods can also be developed for non-isothermal cases. But okay, first we just discuss the most simple case, just to give an example of what we are doing. So approach here is again, not very novel, I would say, but application comes from process control. And in a process control, it is well known that you need to make input-output relationship in order to organize a control loop. So the same principle is here. So first of all, we postulate a nonlinear model of the system. So it should be some nonlinearity. That means if there is no such nonlinearity, then we have a problem, because then it would be no need to do this type of technology. But non-linearity naturally occurs due to Arrhenius dependence of reaction rate on temperature. That's why temperature modulation is the most inviting us to start with. But again, it's also possible to do concentration because not all reactions are first order. There are some also dependent second order and could be also multiple of orders, which just means what 5.5, for example. So this needs to be defined first. And when, again, I will not go too much into detail, but just mention that we go towards derivation of frequency response function, FRF, which are the same process which we do in process control. And we need to analyze the sign and then define how this changes from the forcing parameters. And forcing parameters typically amplitude and frequency. These are two. And usually one is fixed and other is analyzed, and then you can do it vice versa in order to understand the complete place. So this is what is described in process control language. So we have input parameter X, which is periodic, which has a fixed term plus periodic term, which is A cosine omega T. And it will create a periodic response of output parameter, which has two terms. And the most important for us is these DC terms. It's the same as in electrical engineering. It's DC, it means direct current. But these terms is not related to current. It's just historically, it has the same name. And then the periodic harmonics, which are created by input modulation. So what most important part here is the sign of this DC component. And we did in, it looks in terms of harmonics, it has second and fourth and high order harmonics, which contributes, but usually we limit ourselves only to G2. So that means the second order harmonics, which contributes to this term. And then if we know this, and we know whether it's positive, then we 100% sure that effect will be positive under such frequency and such amplitude. If a sign is negative, if you do such modulation, you will get a negative effect. That means your performance will be much worse when at steady state conditions. So what is summary here or take at home message? The dominant term is basically proportional to second harmonics, asymmetrical second order function, which again obtained in the process of transformation of the dimensionalized model. So how reactor model looks like, this is what I took from the book from chemical engineers. So this is just how we teach our students to write equations for transformation of concentration of CA product and temperature as a function of time. So it's general concentration means that input term minus output term minus conversion, which is pre-exponent times E in power activation energy over T times C in general cases in power M, because reaction order can be, as I said, anything but not one. If it's one, then modulation and concentration would not help. The same for product and for temperature are terms which are related to heat in, heat out, heat produced by reaction and heat transfer to environment. Because reactors is also under forced cooling. So the cooling, which is described here in the last term, it also can be a periodic function in general in order to maintain some specific shape of things. Then of course, as all engineers like to make it dimensionless, the next slide just shows the same equations in the dimensionless form by using well-known parameters, which are typically introduced in reactor engineering to make the system dimensionless. So I will not go through them into details, but the most important here that these parameters can be split into several groups. or in three groups, in fact. So one of them, which you could do nothing with it, they are given, and these are kinetic and thermodynamic parameters of chemical system. So you just need to know them and work with them. Second group of parameters, they are physical and thermodynamic parameters of reactor system. Here you have some flexibility. At least you can play with overall heat transfer coefficient by providing a specific cooling regime on throughout the surface of the reactor. And the most easiest part to control is what is concentration, temperature, flow rate, and temperature of coolant. So these four parameters are crucial to create optimal conditions for such operation. And again, for analysis further, it also quite easy to make all parameters dimensionless relative to a steady state. So you just take the real parameters minus value at steady state and normalize it by steady state value. In this case, all concentrations becomes dimensionless between 0 and 1, which mathematicians always like, and I would say engineers too, so because it's much easier to work in a space between 0 and 1. And that's just highlighting this again, not go too much into detail. But once you have done it, you get this type of systems in terms of input-output relationships. So models become dimensionless and can be analyzed further. So remember that we need now to do series expansion in order to just analyze this delta term. However, one more important part is here, and this is stability. So not often this is checked, but the system can only be operating under such conditions if there is a stable condition. That means any deviation from a steady state would result that the system would return into a steady state if a time goes to infinity. So this is often overlooked. Sometimes it could be trivial, of course, but not always. If you have an exothermic reaction or if you have a relatively low heat removal rate, the situation may result in a situation where the heating produced by reaction will be increasing, and when you go to runaway situation, which obviously not the main idea of this method. You at some point, of course, if reactor is not melted, then you eventually reach upper steady state, but this is not something which we want. So in order to check this, we also do this internal check, and this is again standard procedure. We need to write a characteristic equation. And for every reactor, it's its own equation. So this is written for non-isothermal STCR. And solution of these are three solutions because this is characteristic polynomial of power three. And the only stability equation requires that A part should be below zero and B part should be above zero. So maybe it's more easy to demonstrate it by this plot. So in every system, we have four regimes. And only one of them, parametric space, only one of them is interested to us. And this is a stable oscillatory regime, which is expressed here in terms of these parameters A and B, which is solution of characteristic term for non-isothermal STCR reactor. We are not interested, of course, in stable non-oscillatory regime. As I said, this is possible, but not interesting. Unstable oscillator is forbidden because that's already mentioned. This is just impossible to operate close to this line. And we basically first need to check with our conditions, which will be fine, needs to be inside this area between a blue red of curve on the left hand side. When you done it, you will get such a response function, which in fact shows you the term G2, which we introduced, that's the second harmonic term, as a function of frequency inside stable regime at a constant amplitude. Of course, it's important conditions, and of course, it's constant steady state. So all other parameters except the amplitude are constant. This is important. Yeah? So if you want to do analysis for other steady state, the whole process needs to, of course, go in from scratch and then to repeat it. Yet it's not much work. Once the transfer functions are ready, analysis becomes relatively straightforward. So you can see one example here that shows that there are also non-dimensionless frequency. It's also frequency divided by the actual frequency. And in this case, it can go from 10 minus 2 to 10 power 2. And you can see that depending on reaction order, you may get a different responses. So for example, if reaction order is 0.5, you will get a positive gain, but very little. In all other cases, you will get negative gain. That means your any frequency in this range will be creating situation which is worse than your steady state situation. And the answer is no go. So you should not consider this steady state because this is not good. So potentially you need to change initial concentration or change amplitude and try to find operational space without even looking into such a scenario. What I also want to say that reaction order is really matters here, and it no direct observation how it would change for transition from 0.5 to 2 here, but it can also be in non-linear or highly non-linear way. So if you know reaction order, you need to repeat this again. So the summary, the method is approximate, only works at small amplitude because we do series expansion and we are only limited at one periodic term. It can be applied to any shape of input perturbation. I particularly chosen sine because it was easy, but in general, it can be applied for any other type of periodic input. And it gives answers to several questions. So whether we can improve performance or not, what range of frequencies we need to use in order to improve performance, and are the optimal values of amplitude. So this needs to be fixed first and then to do this analysis. And it also can give you approximate extent because from the value here of G2, it can be calibrated to actual response in percent of selectivity or in percent of reaction rate enhancement. So now after I introduced this, let me just, I will not show you all steps because it would require another lecture, but I just want to show application wise. So as I said, we are interested in the sugars to convert them into higher valued products. And this is one of the chains and transformations where maltose gives glucose, and glucose can be going on to multiple ways. Sorbitol is a useful product, but not so highly useful as fructose. Fructose has much higher added value, and mannitol is also another byproduct, but it has low commercial value. So the interest is, of course, how we started with research at steady state. If you only do steady state and you do hydrogenation, for example, you will get sorbitol with almost 100% selectivity. However, it's very difficult to get fructose. It's almost impossible unless you use very specific catalyst, which requires quite a specific design. And that's what also was demonstrated in paper from, as I said, 2013. So this reaction has two kinetics. And if you add some hydrogen into it, it basically needs to maintain catalyst in a reduced state. So it goes to mainly sorbitol and very small amount of fructose were formed. And when we started to understand why it's wet, and we did just analysis and activity goal with temperature selectivity stays very high. And when we thought that let's investigate the point here around 120 degrees, because this is what provides some potential for improvement via periodic operation. Why? Because as I said, kinetic is nonlinear and we can decouple surface coverage from the concentration and fluid phase if we do fast modulation, which may result in very interesting effects. This can be done by inductive heating. Let's not forget about this main topic. I will very briefly talk about technological part of it in the coming 10 minutes, I think. And then also I will show examples of dynamic modulations. So as I said, it's a complex approach which requires several parts. I touched only now the mechanistic part, but it's also how to create fast modulation in a periodic way and how to make composite catalyst design. So the composite catalyst design is important because the heating needs to be very close to reactive centers, you know, if you want to do it fast. Of course, you can get mechanical mix, as I showed previously, but this would result in a delay for heat transfer. So you can use, of course, the zone of heating material and zone of catalytic material. It has advantage that you can separate them by external magnet because magnetic material can be removed and catalyst will stay. But here it does not work because you really need to go to more intimate contact between these two in order to reduce the time for transfer of energy from magnetic part to catalytic part. And these are two materials which we are looking. So one of them porous polymer support in which we embed both of them. And this one HPS cross-linked polymer looks like this, and it can go to reactor. The color is because we have this magnetic material in it, and it can also be impregnated with catalytic function. It has several advantages. It's very high specific area, and it's much higher stability and lifetime, especially if you use noble metals, this is important. And also it provides good hydrodynamics. So the flow, especially if you operate with gas liquid flow, can go through it with relatively small pressure drop. And another type of materials is 3D printed structure, it's ceramics. I could also show it here. So these are really, as I've shown on a picture, maybe it's easy to see and on my hand. So these materials are produced by creating a paste which contains a salt gel type, or in fact, material which under inking to layer by layer produce these type of structures. And when it goes to the calcination furnace and final structure is produced, which can be heated by inductive heating on its own. And when you need to deposit as a wash coat or some other material, which will be catalytically active. So these materials are made from this type of microtubes. We published a few papers, one of them in Ceramics International, where we studied effect of temperature on the heating properties. And it's not surprising that there is an optimal size, because if you are wrong in size, then heating behavior becomes very little. And if you're too low in temperature, they are amorphous. So this is what's shown here in a TEM picture. So you see on the left-hand side, the structures are not yet sharp enough. So there is still low crystallinity. And it's also confined to NIX-RD. Middle section is kind of good. It's good sharp edges and the size of particles 25 microns, sorry, nanometers. And the right-hand side looks the same, but the scale bar is different. So these are roughly 2.5 times larger and they are simply too big. So it's very important to keep material which absorb in a specific range of radio frequency. As I actually mentioned, at 300 kilohertz, this is our target frequency. So we develop materials which operates around it. And essentially we are targeting also at high efficiency. So far we demonstrated 86% with these materials for conversion of electric energy to heat, which is obviously exceeds the internal combustion engine and other technologies. So that's very important to keep a very good control. So why is that? That's what also very briefly presented in this slide, because we really need to work in this red zone where we have kind of a system with single domain. And once they becomes ferromagnetic, so they start to lose their coercivity. Because coercivity, this is in fact, the, every material has a parameter which characterizes its property to keep some magnetization when external field is removed. And when you have multi-domain, they are canceling out each other, and total coercivity decreases. But inductive heating is directly proportional to coercivity of material. And if you're on the left-hand side, in terms of its size, then simply magnetic domains are too small. So there is an optimum, and that's important just to know. And that's what I want to tell about these particular materials. So once we know materials, we know how to do a theory, and now we go to application. Application, this is microkinetic model for glucose hydrogenation isomerization, it's combined. And I will again not go through many steps here, it's a lumped model, but it's good enough for applications in this particular system. So in fact, it shows that the glucose absorbed and desorbed, it's equilibrium, and hydrogen absorption goes via atomic state. And then surface reactions and desorption. And when we do periodic temperature modulation with a function like here, where T0 agreed 120 degrees centigrade, that's what we have chosen. And then amplitude and frequency, these are parameters which needs to be optimized. So again, this is the reason for effect. Again, I mentioned there are two kinetics here, which is published in 2013, the paper, if you want to look further. So it's very fast kinetics, which happens very quickly, let's say less than 30 seconds, and then conversion really drops, and then followed by slow kinetics. So it's schematically, it's shown like this. That's and on top of it, it's also isomerization kinetics, which is not presented here, but it also goes in parallel, as I explained originally. So that's when you have such situation, it's quite common for adsorption of sugars on the metal. So in fact, you have fast kinetic and slow kinetics of hydrogenation. So then the system has a very good potential to be exploited. So when, again, technical size about reactor, I think not go too much into detail. I think I already explained this in the beginning. So reactor is positioned inside the coil. And here it's just the inlet and outlet. And these are the path which goes to frequency generator to change its frequency in a desirable range. And when we want to do this type of periodic modulation, here is just shown around 20 degrees, but in general, it can be done around every temperature. And what happens is that we obviously have desorption and adsorption to every cycle of this field reversal. Very important how to measure temperature, because temperature can be measured quickly or needs to be measured quickly. And normal thermocouples are usually not good enough for it because they still have response times in order of 1 second. And in some applications, if you want to go to fast modulation, you really need to do something like this, which is infrared thermometer. Due to COVID, they are very popular now and the price decreased quite considerably. So they measure temperature on a surface, but if you have also the walls of, or we can make windows from infrared transparent material, then you can also measure temperature directly on your catalyst. We are working towards these applications as well. So what happens if you do such type of modulation? Your surface coverages are changing. So here we are shown at three different type of periodic modulation. So this is period of 25 seconds. On the top right, you see 60 seconds. And at the bottom, you see 180 seconds. That's the prediction of kinetic, microkinetic model, how coverages of hydrogen, glucose, and temperature, the black one, are changing as a function of time. And you see that there is not periodic, first of all, they are not symmetrical. So for example, if you see the black curve is always symmetrical because that's the temperature, we want to keep it a sine function, but the other two are not. If you integrate them around steady state, you will see that there is a gain. And these parameters, especially for 25 seconds, are very good for application towards the making the product fructose as a main product. If you just can predict such behavior, you know that we need to operate in this range where the effect becomes positive for glucose transformation. Because for glucose transformation, we really need to create a situation when hydrogen coverage is below an average. As I mentioned, hydrogen is needed just to maintain catalyst in the right state, because without it, it would not work long. And you cannot make a periodic operation. So we continuously need to feed hydrogen. So let's look what happens. So that's the most important slide. So once you change the period of modulation and do it correctly at these parameters, an amplitude 12K, which is also important, you see that you put the situation upside down. So in fact, at steady state, as I already presented before, the sorbitol was 90 plus selectivity with very little yield of fructose. But if you go to 22nd period, the situation becomes opposite. You will get 90% of fructose and only 10% sorbitol, which is less valuable product. So why is that? It would require, as I said, some more explanation, but I have no time. So we analyze the section, which is gives the periodic term. This is delta. And then we chosen frequency and amplitude such that to maximize the effect. Because in fact, here we are interested in fructose. Why we cannot go further? Because these are technical limitations. The model predicts that it should be still better, but the last experimental point here is at 23 seconds, of a period of 23 seconds. So if we want to go further to prove this concept, we would need to redesign our system and to do some further modifications, which are ongoing. Yet, it's also important for amplitude. It's very unperiodic, and you see here some particular solutions are presented. So if you not select the amplitude correctly, you know, you do it between 12, for example, 14 degrees Kelvin amplitude, the situation would be again completely opposite from the situation I just you presented. And when it goes with such a case, which can only be understood if you see the corresponding G2 signs of this second term, which can tell you which conditions are good and which conditions are not good. But once you've done it, you don't need to search for it. You just do experiment and you will get what you expect to get. That's the strongest part of this method. The same happens in maltose, because as you remember, maltose is an original product from which you generate glucose. So if you start with maltose in one go, there is also effect, but less pronounced. And of course, it may be interesting to feed directly maltose into the reactor and to get the situation when you get high yield of glucose. And it again happens at small periods, that means at high frequency. And again, due to technical limitation, we cannot go further towards this direction. So just to conclude here, with continuous flow technology for glucose isomerization and transformation, in fact, is just has in a good agreement with the derivation of transfer functions in a frequency response method. So if you do correct design of your catalyst and catalyst support and you bring magnetic and catalytic part together, the effect will be also observed experimentally, not only theoretically, but experimentally. And of course, we demonstrated this up to 30 kilogram per day scale. Going forward requires further modification of the system, as I mentioned, if you want to go to higher frequency. But then second parameter, which I don't have time now to discuss, is economics. It's not goes for free, and every up and down in terms of temperature results that energy is lost. So next to understanding how much improvement in conversion, we also need to do quite a critical review how much additional energy would cost. For fine chemicals, probably this is still not the case because energy costs are typically 5% in total production. Yet for some other systems, which goes to bulk chemistry, this method may be less applicable. Still, could be other parameters of interest because we also looking into photocatalysis where we can do light modulation. We can also look into pulse operation in terms of flow or flow reversal, which is called pulsating reactor, where you can also enhance the product yield just partially because better mixing, but it's also partially because it's periodic change of flow rate, which can also be modulated. And the last I want to thank my team. So in Eindhoven, there are three PhD students, Julia Felicia, Yan Liu, Sihan Kanz, supported by Dr. Sui Li. And the collaborators is also have part-time position at Warwick. We also have two students there. And collaborators from Germany, from Italy, and from China are acknowledged. This is done in framework of ERC Advanced Grant, which is still ongoing until 2025. So we hope that maybe next time I would present much better results also in terms of scaling up the technology. The small scale is already transferred via proof of concept grant, which goes to a company, a spin-out company, which called Stoli Catalysts. While the name may be changed in the future, because effect is not mainly due to catalyst, but this, we call it dynamics, yeah, the enhanced reactor dynamics. And this is really has some potential to also be implemented in flow chemistry applications at small to medium scale with sectors like pharma and fine chemicals. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Professor Rebrov. That was very inspiring. I will now open the floor to the people. If there are any questions, either raise your hand or put it in the chat, please. Thank you. It doesn't seem that there are any questions right now. It might be the good weather that, Erling is, Erling, please go ahead.
Yes, hello, Erling Steenby from the Technical University of Denmark. I'm wondering how you, how much, how well you can model these processes compared to classical catalytic processes. Are you using similar tools? Or how are you going to, if you're going to enter this in a process simulator, for instance?
Now, so far, it's limited to relatively simple kinetics. We consider three case studies. This kinetics is typically needs to be known because what we are not doing with what to develop kinetic models ourselves because we just take it from literature or sometimes we do some machine learning to educate the system what it could be in case of parameters and that's also could be approach. But in generally, the methods are developed in MATLAB. So because we need to do Fourier transform and that's what MATLAB function tools can do. And then, of course, if kinetics is very, very complicated, the transfer function will be the main task to develop the transfer functions. Once you know it, when analysis becomes relatively straightforward. So it can't, if you do it by hand, it's also possible. And in the past, in the 60s, let's say they had no MATLAB, so we had to do it by hand. Mm-hmm. I also learned from them, it's just some manuscripts also from that time when they demonstrated this for the first time. And partially the method was applied already for reverse flow reactor. It's basically a different type of technology, but essentially the same principle, because we have to search for best regimes when the flow needs to be reversed. But here we don't need to reverse flow, we just need to change periodically the flow rate. But the tools are the same, I would say. It can be done with pen and paper, it can be done in MATLAB, but there are four steps, as I say. So first, we know kinetic model, when we need to make it dimensionless in terms of input-output relationship, when we need to transfer this from time domain to frequency domain, and when we can analyze responses in frequency domain, because this is much easier.
Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you so much, Professor Rebrov. I think this presentation will be put online on the Eurotech platform and on our YouTube channel. If there are any questions, please forward them to either Eurotech or to Professor Rebrov directly. And we will have a new session in 2 weeks, maybe the last before the summer holidays. Looking forward to see you there. So thank you everybody for joining, and enjoy the weather. If it's good where you are, at least here in Brussels, it's very sunny. So enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you.
Thank you.